Hello YouTube, today I'm going to give you 5 tips, 5 things to follow in your life for better quality of sleep. Sleep is super important, it's the part of recovery to me that is the least discussed, the most underrated as well, because your diet can be on point, your training can be excellent, you can have low stress levels, but if you don't sleep enough or if you don't sleep well, it's all for nothing. And we'll see that there are qualitative differences in sleep, meaning that you can sleep a lot, but at the end of the day, you didn't get the benefit of a long night of sleep because it was poor quality. And the opposite can also be true. If you only get a minimum amount of sleep, but you optimize it at the best you can, it can be excellent and you can wake up fresh. So first off, we all are different when it comes to sleep. And science has pretty much proven that it's genetic, 100%. Some people can sleep 4 hours and be fine. Other people need more. I think that a common trend among people is the more we age, the less we need to sleep. And for most people, we stabilize around 7-8 hours. That's what we need to fall rested. I've always found personally that once you're an adult, the amount of sleep you need is going to be perfectly determined by your natural cycles, meaning that let's say you go to sleep and you don't have an alarm and there's no sun or exterior noises to wake you up. When you naturally wake up, this is the amount of sleep you need. Of course, this experiment can't be sort of sabotaged if you were tired, if you had what I call a sleep debt and you were sleep deprived, or if you took some stimulants. But if you want to try it one day and make sure that the variables are clean, then you might find out your exact needs when it comes to sleep. Of course, the amount of training that you did before, the amount of stress, of physical activity also play a role. All of that to say what? All of that to say that you should be pretty aware of how much sleep you need. Sadly, in this modern world, we end up not sleeping enough. And that's just the way it is. You have to go to work. You have to wake up when the alarm tells you wake up, and sometimes you just don't get enough rest. So we have to be able to maximize the recovery aspect of the little hours of sleep we get. It gets worse when you become a parent, of course, because you have a baby who wakes you up. But for these people too, it shouldn't be the end of the world. You should still be able to lift and make gains. So 5 tips today, and I am going to try and keep in mind the insomnia aspect of things. Insomnia for some people can be genetic, it can be passed down, it can be environmental, but for everyone, the things that I'm going to share will and can help. So listen up. First one is going to be your body temperature. You fall asleep better when your body temperature is low. This is why you're usually advised to open the windows when you sleep so that the room where you sleep is nice and cool. But what is the point of the room being cool? It's so that you can be cool, so that the room can make your body temperature lower. And when you sleep, your body naturally goes into lower body temperatures. So in a sense, when you go to bed already cold, you're tricking your body into falling asleep. This is also why if you live in a country that is Arctic with a lot of snow and it gets actually really cold, you are told if you go outside during a tempest, do not fall asleep. When you are in a snowstorm, it can be really tempting to stop and rest underneath that tree, but if you do, you're never going to wake up because your body is cold, it wants to sleep, but if you go in that sleep, you will enter hypothermia and die. That's sort of grim, but it gives you an indication that if you are cold, you're going to fall asleep better. So how do we do that? Well, first off, as I said, cold room, right? Open the window if you can. And the best way to ensure that you're cold and you fall asleep quick is a cold shower. A cold shower before bed will make you sleepy like you have no idea, especially in summer, because your body is going to still retain the coldness long enough for you to fall asleep before the heat starts becoming uncomfortable. It's also true in winter, but it's less useful. When you take a cold shower, I made a video about cold shower, you need to really let the cold seep in. Don't just rinse and exit. You need to stay underneath it until you're really cold so that you're cold to the bones And I guarantee you, once you're in bed with that cover and that pillow, you're going to fall asleep like this. That's number one. Number two is going to be food. Some people, if they sleep before bed, they can't sleep or they have food nightmares. Some people also find that if they sleep right going before going to bed, they get sleepy. I'm like this. If I have a meal, I'm sleepy for an hour. That's always been the case. Any class I ever had in high school, in college, after lunch was a nightmare because I was falling asleep, even though I slept a lot of hours during the night. But that's something you can use to your advantage, you know? If you know that you have trouble sleeping and your meal time is at 8 and you go to bed at, I don't know, 10 p.m., modify your meal schedule so that they all happen earlier in the day, so that your last meal happens at 9:30. That way, when you go to bed, you're going to just sleep through it immediately. Some people also find that if they have a lot of carbs in their meal, it makes the effect even stronger. So that might be something to research, and that's also quite effective. And that's an easy trick, right? As far as hunger goes, some people can sleep hungry. In my house, we used to say that people had sleep for dinner. That's when you were just so tired that you didn't even feel the hunger anymore. You just went to bed. I find it funny because when you wake up, you would think that you would have ravenous hunger, but you actually don't. It's an interesting thing. And I've always found also, and that's out of topic, but when I have a huge meal before bed, I wake up starving, just the way it is. But that can also be used to advantage because let's say you're the type of person who actually does better when they're hungry because you get sleepier for some reason, then you can utilize that for your meal plan. As far as number three goes, number three, we're going to stay with things that you ingest, but this time I'm going to tell you not to do it, and it's going to be caffeine. I know a lot of people love their caffeine, they love their coffee. Might be strange coming from a Frenchman, but I don't personally drink coffee. I drink it once in my life, it did nothing for me. And I just don't like stimulants in general, so I don't consume it. And you also shouldn't consume it. The issue with coffee is, a lot of people like to think that they're being reasonable with coffee. Reality is, you're most likely not. You most likely drink too much coffee. And the issue with coffee is, it affects your sleep more than you think, right? Unless you have that cup of coffee at 7 a.m. and then you don't touch it for the rest of the day, which even if you do that, you still have caffeine in your blood, that affects your quality of sleep. But if you have a cup at like lunch, at noon, it still affects your sleep. And the issue with coffee too is that it's a vicious circle because you're not going to be able to fall asleep at night. You're going to wake up early, you're going to be tired, and what are you going to do to fight that? You're going to drink coffee. And so that cycle repeats. And what you're basically doing is you're borrowing energy, because when you drink coffee, what's bringing the energy is not the caffeine in the coffee. The caffeine is a trigger telling your body to produce that energy. Energy that you don't have. So you're accumulating a debt, and the more coffee you drink, the more you build up a resistance to it, the more you have to drink, and you're going to end up in a deadlock where you're going to basically have triggered insomnia within you. It's coffee insomnia. So you have to get sober. You have to stop drinking coffee. You have to reduce your caffeine consumptions. The same goes for energy drinks and pre-workouts. If you take your pre-workout at 7 p.m. to train at 9 or at 8, no wonder you cannot sleep. And the issue is that sleep is key for gains. So you're hurting yourself. When you drink your coffee or your pre-workout to have a better workout, you might have better performances, but the fruits that those performances are going to bear are not pretty much non-existent. And if you bodybuild, you're thinking about this the wrong way. Who cares about the weight you lift? It's about what it does to your muscles and the way they recover. So you have to rethink this. Your relationship with caffeine needs to be rethinked. That's number three. Number four, we're going to talk about the environment you surround yourself with when it comes right before sleeping. So we've all heard about blue screens. We've all heard about lights. You do not want to look at screens before bed. I'm going to be perfectly honest with you. I have no issues with that. I can be staring at a laptop 5 minutes before bed and I can sleep like a baby. That being said, it's because I also respect all of the other the points that I'm bringing you in this video, so it might be why. If you are not 100% on some of these, you might be more susceptible to getting hyped up by blue light. So you want to prevent that from happening if you're that type of person. As far as the environment goes, I will also advise you to make the bedroom a sacred place. You do not bring your phone in the bedroom. You do not have a TV in the bedroom. As far as relationship goes, also if you're in a couple, that's the best way to kill your relationship. Do not bring a laptop in the bedroom. If you can, that's everyone says they're going to do it, they never do. If you can prevent pets from going into the bedroom, you can try. If you have a cat, you already lost. They're going to eventually make their way into that bedroom. But that bedroom is for sleep and other things. But mainly sleep. And you also need to make the act of laying sacred. What do I mean by that? Take my example. I only lay down when I sleep. This is not an exaggeration. I never lay down. Meaning that when I lay down, my body immediately knows it's time to sleep. Laying down makes me sleepy. And you will find that with people who don't lay down as much, when they do lay down, they fall asleep immediately. Why? Your body is programmed for that. It knows that this position is to sleep. So if the only moment where you lay down is in bed before sleep, it's going to be that ritual immediately that clicks. It's like a routine. And that is super effective. But if you have the tendency to lay down on your couch and watch TV, or you lay on the floor, I don't know why you would do that, but some people are strange, you're breaking that cycle and it's no good. So make sure that you try and rebuild that, because it's part of the ritual, it's part of the environment of the bedroom. So that's number four. Number five, I'm going to talk about broader schemes of life, like stress and like the relationship you have with sleep. So stresses in life are gonna happen. You can't have a life without stress. And if you could, it would be a very boring life, because stresses are problems that arise, it's confrontation, and it's what we're built to do. We're built to solve problems as humans. That being said, you cannot let those problems follow you in the bedroom. And the issue with a lot of people is that they think too much. And that's where insomnia comes into play. A lot of people who have insomnia, the actual problem they have is not hormonal. It's that the insomnia has become a psychological issue that built itself up. Meaning what? They experience insomnia. And then when they do, when they go to bed, they're afraid that they're going to again have insomnia. So they trigger it. You see that with people who have panic attacks. Usually the first panic attack is triggered by the environment. And after that, the other ones are triggered by the psyche. Meaning that the person is going to have a symptom of a panic attack, and are going to immediately associate it with the bad experience they had once, and it's going to repeat itself until they can break the cycle. It's up to you to break the cycle with insomnia. You do all of the tips that I gave you before, and you go to bed confident that you're going to sleep. And people tell you to not think about anything. I've always thought that that tip was bad. Why? Because when you try to apply that tip, what you're essentially doing is telling yourself, I am not thinking about anything right now because I would really like to fall asleep. And by doing that, you're keeping your brain awake. What you want is, you want to let your brain drift off. I don't know how other people are. Personally, for me, I never remember the moment I fall asleep. Never. I couldn't tell you what happened before I fall asleep. It just happens. And I think before it happens. I'm thinking about all sorts of things. I'm thinking about my day. How was my training today? What I'm going to do next day? How was my volume? Which variations am I going to rotate? How is next week shaping up? What do I want to do this weekend? Is it going to be nice? All of these are running through my head. I'm thinking all of the time, all throughout the day. But eventually, I fade away and I wake up rested. So all of these tips need to be applied across the board. And they represent multiple facets of life, of course. It might take some time for you to get them under control, especially if you have developed bad habits. But you're going to find that a lot of the time, what prevents you from falling asleep is either things that you do to yourself or things that you're psyching yourself out of. A lot of people, for example, I call it being too lazy to sleep, meaning that they wait too long to go to sleep and then they know they should be sleeping, but they don't even have the energy to do that. This means you missed the cycle, you missed the train, and it's your fault. You know when it's time to go to sleep, just like you know when it's time to train. And it's the same thing. A lot of people complicate it. They say, a cycle of sleep is 2 hours or 1.75 or 3 hours and you need this much. I say, go to bed whenever you can, fall asleep as early as you can, And then the quality of sleep is what's going to make or break your life. It's what's going to make or break your gains. You cannot necessarily control the amount of time you sleep, but you can control how much you get from those hours of sleep. And that's the point of this video. So any questions you might have about sleeping, things that I didn't talk about, let me know in the comments. I'm just going to end up by saying that I do not recommend you take sleeping pills. I always recommend you try to fix your body yourself instead of taking drugs. So that's it for the day. Thank you for watching and have a good night.